because we cannot substitute you. Dr. Nitish Gupta, MD-DM, FSM, assistant professor from Maulana Azad Medical College, and he is going to deliver. Actually, I'm sorry to speak like this. It should have been done much ahead of this. However, I think you are all waiting. Thank you, please.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. So we'll be, over next 20, 25 minutes, we'll be discussing about the antifungal therapy, the various fungi which we deal in day-to-day care, in critical care, and how do we manage them. So what we'll cover is aspergillus and other opportunistic fungi like mucor, short talks on candida, cryptococcus, endemic fungi like histoplasma, blasto, coccidio. Histoplasma has come up big way in last 2-3 years. Now, earlier it used to be considered endemic only to US, but now we see a lot of, at least a once or twice a month, we see one or the other case being reported from any part of the country. So fungal morphology and culture, yeast are single cell fungi, molds are multicellular hyphae, and dimorphic fungi, those who have both the forms. Antifungal drugs are classified in 4 categories based on their mechanism of action. They are polyenes, they are azoles, echinocandins, and anti-metabolites. Polyenes like amphotericin B, which again comes in 4 different forms. Azoles like fluconazole, vori, itra, posuvaconazole, and newer kid is isuvaconazole. Echinocandins, anadulafungin, caspofungin, and micafungin. And anti-metabolite like 5-fluorocytosine. So this is the basically a diagrammatic representation of the spectrum which these drugs cover. As we can see, M4B covers a lot of areas, majorly all the candida species, cryptococcus species, aspergillus fumigatus, and dimorphic fungi. Against mucorales and fusarium, it has less sensitivity. On the other hand, if we see posaconazole among azoles is the broadest spectrum drug, which covers candida major species, all the aspergillus species, mucor, fusarium, and the dimorphic fungi. So first we'll discuss a few points about aspergillus. In this we'll be covering invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, chronic necrotizing pulmonary aspergillosis, aspergilloma, and ABPA. So aspergillus is basically a regular septate hyphae which has dichotomous branching, that is 45 degrees. So anytime your microbiologist or your pathologist writes regular septations in 45 degree branching, it is aspergillosis. It is pathogenic to human, comes through inhalation of spores. Most common species are fumigatus and flavus. Less commonly, you see niger, teres, or versicolor in humans. So aspergillus infection, how will an aspergillus infection after the inhalation manifest into a clinical disease depends on your immune function, either immune dysfunction or your immune hyperreactivity. If you have immune dysfunction, the more severe the dysfunction, the higher the chances of invasive aspergillosis, followed by less chances of subacute invasive aspergillosis, or it may just cause colonization in form of simple aspergilloma, aspergillus bronchitis, or if there's a cavity and they progress, it's a chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. On the other spectrum, if there is an hyperactivity in the immune dysfunction, it leads to ABPA and severe asthma with fungal sensitization. So talking about invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, sinopulmonary tract infection, so it is not limited just to lung, sinus is also involved, or in the form of isolated tracheobronchitis, most commonly seen in HIV positive and lung transplant recipients. It presents as a similar presentation like other infectious disease like fever, cough, sputum production, dyspnea. However, mortality rate is very high, up to 50% in untreated patient. There may be vascular invasion presents with aspergillus infections, which may be in the form of infarctions or hemoptysis. It has dissemination rate of about 25%, especially to brain. Who are these patients who develop invasive pulmonary aspergillosis? Those who have severe dysfunction in immune system, like neutropenia is the greatest risk factor. Incidence is 5% in leukemias, chronic granulomatous disease, acute myelogenous leukemia, lung transplant, COPD, and patients on chronic steroid therapy. Histopathology, again, as we have discussed, it's a septated acute branching hyphae. Culture, it grows rapidly, but it is insensitive. Sputum has a higher yield than blood. So if you're looking for aspergillus, sputum samples must be sent. Beta-2-glucan assay, again, will be positive in the fungal because it's a fungal cell wall component, but it's not specific. You may even see candida, even see PCP. This beta-D-glucan is positive. Of course, there is a cross-reactivity with antibiotics like beta-lactams. Then comes the galactomannan antigen test. You can do it either in serum or BAL. Serum galactomannan index more than 1 has high specificity. More than 0.5 has a better sensitivity. In BAL galactomannan, it is about 0.67. Again, you need to be, galactomannan can be positive with beta-lactams as well as with histoplasma infections. PCR with serum or BAL, again very sensitive. So how does the radiology for invasive pulmonary aspergillosis looks like? It can have very non-specific finding to very specific finding. Rounded densities, which are usually plural based, infarction or cavitation. In CT scan, the finding include multiple nodules, a halo sign and an acrescent sign, as ma'am has shown in the morning lecture. So this is how a halo sign looks like, a hyperdensity surrounded by a halo. And this is how an acrescent sign looks like. So BAL has a fungal smear and culture, highly specific. Sensitivity is about 3 to 50%. But if it is positive, it is positive. Transbronchial biopsies do not increase your sensitivity very much above your BAL. So when you are planning a transbronchial biopsy to suspect invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, it has to be done under very controlled circumstances. This is how a patient of how a bronchoscopic appearance of invasive aspergillosis looks like. You can see black marks and a lot of vascular hyperinflammation seen surrounding it. Patient presented with bilateral pneumonia and ARDS, and we can see lot of fungal hyphae seen in the endobronchial lung biopsy. How do we treat invasive pulmonary aspergillosis? There was a trial done back 2002, published in NEJM, where they compared the voriconazole therapy versus amphotericin B therapy, and voriconazole therapy worked better as compared to amphotericin B as a first line management for invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. What are other options for treating invasive pulmonary aspergillosis? Isavuconazole is now approved. Posaconazole has approval for prophylaxis only for invasive pulmonary aspergillosis, especially in patients with myelodysplastic syndromes, graft versus host disease, or AML. Possibly combine them with echinocandins for severe disease. And reports are now there from drug resistance from some parts of the world to the therapy. The other spectrum where the aspergillosis has coming up in last 2-3 years, or maybe we are diagnosing them more because a lot of knowledge has come in this field, is chronic necrotizing pulmonary aspergillosis. Typically occurs in patients with pre-existing lung disease or who have some level of immunosuppression. Symptoms are similar, fever, malaise, cough, night sweats. There's a line about chronic necrotizing pulmonary aspergillosis is a community-acquired pneumonia which doesn't go away. Basically, you have responded, patient is not responsive to your antibiotic therapy. You must start thinking about whether it is chronic necrotizing pulmonary aspergillosis. Treatment is again with azoles, voriconazole and itraconazole. For severe patients, amphob and caspofungin can be tried. The main treatment remains, eliminate the risk factor. If patient has uncontrolled diabetes and a post-tubercular sequelae, try to get his diabetes under control. That will only help his cause of treatment. Then aspergillosis, fungal ball of hyphae or fibrin lying in a pre-existing pulmonary cavity. What does it cause? It causes hemoptysis episodes. Fever and cough are less common with aspergillomas. How do you confirm whether it's an aspergilloma? Your fungal ball should move in both supine and prone position. If it is not a mobile ball, it is not likely to be an aspergilloma. For asymptomatic patient, you just observe. For other patients, you either go for an antifungal therapy in form of itraconazole, surgical resection, and if hemoptysis is massive, you go for bronchial artery embolization. Rising IgG titers suggest your treatment is failing. Allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis, it's a hyperimmune syndrome, non-invasive, that's why it's different from invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. It presents with fever, with migratory pulmonary infiltrates, cough, brownish mucus plugs. When do you consider? Consider them in the patients who have refractory asthma, difficult to taper off steroids, or with cystic fibrosis. There are many criteria to diagnose ABP. Isham criteria is one which is commonly used. The goal of whole therapy in ABP is to prevent exacerbation, because every exacerbation reduces lung function and increases the chances of mortality. Treatment remains, first line remains, till date remains steroids. However, selected cases where antifungal may be given in replacement to steroids, especially in patients who have already pre-existing steroid toxicity. and follow up with serial IgE to monitor treatment response. Next fungal mucor mycosis again came back in the last COVID wave. Mucor mycosis everywhere, be it ENT, be it pulmonary, be it bones, it was all over the body. It again belongs to mucorrheal order. Species which cause human disease include rhizopus, mucor. It is a ubiquitous saprophytic fungi in soil or decaying organic matter. It transmits again by inhalation of spores. It is a very aggressive pathogen with infection, angioinvasion, thrombosis, and hemorrhagic infarction. These are classical characteristics of mucor, which differentiate it from invasive pulmonary aspergillosis. Rhinocerebral is more commonly seen in neutropenic or diabetics. Pulmonary is seen in severe neutropenics. GI is again seen most commonly in the children, in the neonates. It can be skin infections in primary or secondary. Disseminated may follow any other form, particularly in severe neutropenia. Clinical presentation presents with underlying malignancy, neutropenia, immunosuppressants, and COVID-19 has now been added to the list. Symptoms include fever, cough, pleuritic chest pain, hematogenous spread to the skin. That's why examination of the whole body is important. You get imaging pulmonary nodules and the presence of pleural effusion as compared to invasive pulmonary aspergillosis is more common with mucor mycosis. So these are filamentous, Posse septated hyphae, which branch at 90 degree angle. Aspergillosis branch at 45 degree and septated. This is Posse septated, branch at 90 degree. And 1,2,1,3 beta D glucan and galactomannan are negative when you are suspecting mucor mycosis. So when you have to differentiate between aspergillus and mucor, you send both the test. If they are negative and your microscopy is positive, it is definitely mucor mycosis. Treatment, iron chelation therapy is one of the highest running risk factor, so you stop that therapy. Early suspicion and empiric treatment is very important. You give combination of antifungals, consider surgical resection, talk with the surgeon as early as possible when the surgery can be done. And MFOB is historically first line therapy. Posaconazole and isavuconazole are again now coming up as a alternatives where MFOB cannot be given. How do you differentiate between mucor and IPA? They both are similar because they have same risk factors. They have neutropenia and diabetes. Clinical spectrum remains same. Rhino-sinus disease, they are both aggressive and both need high degree of clinical suspicion. How do they differ? Mucor branch at right angle, septate are absent. Mucor does not have beta-D-glucan positive and should test negative for this assay. Mucor has more pleural involvement as compared to aspergillus. And of course, worse mortality. Moving into the other spectrum of fungal infections like Candida, Cryptococcus, and endemic fungi, we'll be discussing about invasive candidiasis, Candida auris, and other uncommon infections. Invasive candidiasis, again, Candida reservoir is in the body, GI tract and skin. Candida albicans is the most common species found throughout the world. Candida gabbrata, Prospiolis, Tropicalis, these are all lesser numbers. Clinical spectrum, most case in ICU, candidemia, when we suspect it comes with acute dissemination, it does not come in the form of localized lung disease or a localized organ. There will always be signs of dissemination, most commonly seen in the eyes and in skin. 50% of candidemia presents in septic shock, spleen, liver, endovascular structures, kidney are all involved. Isolated is very rare. Peritonitis can follow gut wall injury. Meningitis can complicate because of the following neurosurgical interventions. Candida alone from urine or from respiratory tract usually represents colonization unless you have other signs of dissemination. So this is how a disseminated skin infection looks like, and this is how endophthalmitis looks like. So whenever you are suspecting candidemia, always do a general physical examination of skin and an ophthalmic examination. How do we diagnose? Blood cultures is actually negative in 40-60% of disseminated candidiasis. It takes a long days. Beta-3-D-glucan is a good modality to treat because it has a good sensitivity of 81%. But alone beta-D-glucan positive is not the criteria. There are other fungi also where it cross-reacts. Treatment guidelines remain: remove the catheters. Echinocandins are the treatment of choice for candida infections. Later on, once patients start responding, you can shift to azole if it is sensitive. Lot of cases have now coming up where azoles are resistant. Candidemia alone is there, then 2 weeks negative after blood culture. But if the evidence of endophthalmitis is also there, 4 to 6 weeks is the minimum duration of therapy. Whether should I start candidemia prophylaxis? There is again inconsistent literature which do not give clear-cut guidelines in whom, in which group of patients you can give and in which group of patients there is no use. If there is colonization of two or more sites, say urine is also saying candida, your sputum is also saying candida, the guidelines have suggested that consider 1 week of fluconazole therapy. Candida auris, we are specifically discussing candida auris because it spreads in healthcare settings. Lot of international data, lot of Indian data has now come up in ICUs that candida auris is a most prevalent species in ICUs. The problem with this is it is resistant to azoles, the most common drug which is started for candida infection in ICU. It is 90% resistant to fluconazole, 40% resistant to M4B. So if your candida auris is diagnosed, the treatment of choice shifts to echinocandins. And implement contact isolation for known cases. Blastomycosis, a dimorphic fungi, again presents with chronic pneumonia. Imaging can be anything, a normal pneumonia, a invasive pneumonia, it can be anything. Skin is the second most common site of infection. Lesions are ulcerative or varicose. Severity is worse in immunocompromised patient. And it looks like anybody who has played the 10-ball game, it just looks like this. Antigen test is used for in urine, serum, or bile. Culture is the gold standard to detect blastomycosis. Treatment, again, depends on severity. Very severe cases are treated with M4B. Mild to moderate are treated with itraconazole. However, if the disease is CNS-based, M4B is the drug of choice. Coccidioidomycosis, also known as valley fever or desert rheumatism. Mostly, it is an asymptomatic phase. 60% it passes on as a community-acquired pneumonia. Clues when we do not call coccidioidomycosis as a community-acquired pneumonia, if patient has lymphadenopathy, patient has eosinophilia, or patient has skin manifestations like erythema nodosum. Again, antibodies and isolation of spherules, which is seen on day 5 in human inoculation. Treatment, we give if symptoms persist for more than 6 weeks, we consider treatment with fluconazole or amphotericin B. Histoplasmosis, again, it is the mechanism of inhalation by inhalation of microconidia. Again, it's a self-limited disease in most of the people, but where it spreads, it may manifest like an ARDS. Nodules, which can be falsely PET positive. Bronchiolithiasis, which can obstruct your bronchus airways. Fibrosing mediastinitis is one of the classical presentation. So if your radiologist reports them as fibrosing mediastinitis or lymph nodes do not follow a regular pattern which a lymph node should follow. They are irregular, crossing margins, pleura is also getting involved. Then histoplasmosis is a very strong preclinical probability. Suspect disseminated disease and acute pulmonary disease. We detect it by antigen, where serum sensitivity is 81% and specificity is 98%. But in a immunocompetent patient with suspected pulmonary disease, antibody comes positive after at least 2 to 6 weeks. So in acute case, you can use the antigen. In chronic case, antibody is a better option. If the disease is mild, you just observe. If it is moderate, you give itraconazole. If it is severe, amphotericin B is drug of choice. PCP, again, we all see these cases a lot. Not many of the time these come positive, diagnosed based on clinical, radiological, and background history. More common in solid organ transplants or HIV patients. Microscopy, ideally with BAL, is very sensitive. With PCR, it is a silent disease. Treatment remains trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole for 21 days. If AA gradient is more than 35 mmHg, you add steroids to it. Otherwise, alternatives are clindamycin plus primaquine or IV pentamidine or trimethoprim plus dapsone or retroviquin, depending on the severity of the disease. Cryptococcosis, again, has two forms, neoformis and Getty. Lungs are the portal of entry and CNS involvement. So whenever a patient has a lung involvement and CNS involvement, you should always keep cryptococcosis in your differential diagnosis. 2 days back, we had diagnosed a patient in our ward whose cryptococcal on microscopy CSF came out to be positive. He came with pneumonia and altered sensorium. MRI had a lesion in brain. Diagnosis, again, by culture, microscopy, or antigen detection. When it is lung, only fluconazole is the therapy. However, if CNS is involved, amphotericin B plus flucytosine, this is one of the indications of using flucytosine in fungal infections. So what are the take-home points? Antifungal therapy, you should choose appropriately. you should identify the organism and according to it only start the antifungal therapy. Many of the places anti-resistance pattern are not known very easily. It is something which you have to request the lab and then they put the for the sensitivity pattern and then we come to know the results later. Fungal disease spread very fast, especially aspergillus and mucus, they don't give you time. Know about your correct dose, your and methods of that giving that formulation. Like amphotericin B liposomal is given differently, amphotericin B complex is given differently, lipid complex is again given differently, plain is given differently. And also know about side effects. Amphotericin B drug is associated with NH side effects that you will forget what patient came with, you will just keep on managing complications of amphotericin B. Thank you.